Okay, welcome to World History AP. And you may say to yourself, what is World History AP? That's a very good question. And I'm glad you asked that. We have 326 days, as you can see here, until the AP test. Well, 326 days, 7 hours, 23 minutes, 57, 6, 5. We are counting down. And so this course moves pretty fast and furiously. And one of the reasons why I want to make this video is because you've probably already started reading 6 glasses, which is what you see there in front of you on the screen, or at least the reading guide to it. By reading this over the summer, it should give you a pretty good jump on the course and the book, which is Strayer's Ways of the World. And hopefully, you'll be set to go when you come in at the beginning of the school year. You'll have a pretty good idea about the actual course we're going to study just by reading this book. So I think it's pretty essential. It's very important. If you want to consider this, it might be pretty important considering the fact that you have a test the first Friday back. So here is the reading guide. And there's, it says The History of the World, 6 Glasses by Tom Standage, written in 2005. Goes over and talks about a little bit about what the book is like. And ask you to do this. Write a summary for each of the sections and for each of the chapters here. And basically they're broken up by the 6 different drinks. And the first 3 you'll find are basically from the first semester. And the second 3 drinks, coffee, tea, and Coca-Cola, you'll find those being about from the Enlightenment through the modern world. That's the second semester. And the epilogue here is just some information about what it is that you've learned and a little bit going further beyond the book. So hopefully you're finding the book easy to read. I don't think it's very difficult to read. It should keep your attention fairly well. If you know anything about history, I think you should connect with it. If you don't know anything about history, it's a good way to, you know, learn and get started with it, because there's going to be a lot to learn during this course. The reading questions are pretty straightforward. How did the discovery of beer, how is that linked to the growth of the first civilizations? There's plenty of reasons for that. First of all, you might consider the fact that drinking water wasn't the safest thing like it is today. I mean, I know a lot of people drink bottled water today because they think the tap water, as you drink it, is not very good for you, and it's actually, in most cases, fine. And a lot cheaper. And I think that Standage goes into great detail, if it's in the copy of your book, about the quality of tap water, and also about, where's the other part here, what about the people who have no access to safe water today? And there are lots of people today that don't have access to safe water. It's interesting because we've kind of come full circle that way. In the beginning, when we were first civilizing, beer was a way for people to boil the water, have a flavorful drink, and it did have some alcohol in it. But the alcohol was pretty well watered down most of the time. It's probably not the kind of beer that we drink today, or the kind of beers we see depicted in Super Bowl commercials, because you probably shouldn't be drinking any beer today. Just, you know, to give you a little hint here, it's illegal. And not good for you either. Take AP Psychology, and I'll teach you some more about that. We'll look at what the brain looks like when alcohol abuse enters into it. And that's not a good picture for a developing brain. So you might want to think twice about doing that sort of thing. One of the reasons why I've never had a drink of alcohol is just because I wanted to have a pretty well-developed brain. And I was getting it beat in on the football field anyway, so I guess I was looking for maybe a counterbalance. It worked pretty well to counterbalance that out. Wine, I've also never had a drink of, or spirits, because I don't drink alcohol. And there are a lot of reasons for that personally. I'm an adult. It's legal. I could do that if I'd like. But I just haven't ever felt like I have a big need to do that. Wine continues our story with the book and talks about how did it differ between Greece and Rome? And a lot of students get those two places a little bit confused. Both wearing some togas, and they both talk about things like democracy and republics. both had slaves. And there's discussion about the status and social status of people within this chapter on wine as well. Really good stuff. We don't spend a ton of time in the classical era, not like you would in maybe a level history class or in the past, the way we used to teach world history. It's pretty Eurocentric, meaning that it's centered on Europe. Fortunately, people have decided that this course is called World History, and I think it is fortunate because now we can have a much bigger and broader look at the rest of the world, not just Europe. Spirits is the next section here, and you're going to find out that, and it's not a question in here that I can see as I'm looking at it here real quickly, but I think one of the more interesting questions in that chapter is, why do people of the Islamic faith, Muslims, why do they decide not to drink alcohol? And why do Christians drink it and don't outlaw it in legal code or look down upon it too much? In fact, it's used in the church, in church ceremonies. So there is a American Revolution to consider here, believe it or not. We'll talk about it very briefly, but that's what your junior year is for, I guess. Talk about America then, all 200 years. And it says here, what were the negative effects and uses of spirits? I really wasn't sure before I read this book, you know, how did they even make a drink like that? Well, it's interesting to know they evaporate the alcohol. It evaporates at a different temperature, kind of separates from the rest of the water, and it makes a much stronger drink when you recompose that and pull that back together. And I wasn't... and still I'm not very good expert on these three alcoholic drinks. But these other three drinks here, the three caffeinated drinks, I tend to, well, here's Dr. Pepper. We're in Texas, so I might as well partake in that. Refreshingly caffeinated. And of course, doesn't have any, well, very little coffee in it. But this was mine from this morning, from our nice Starbucks down the street here. And also my coffee maker over there. coffee, cola, and tea, which I'm also a big fan of, those three things involved with worldwide trade, the distribution of not just the drink itself, but culture as well. And you see the first image here at the top is a picture of a woman carrying out a tray of coffee and serving that in what we consider the Eastern world, or at least the border of that. I think that's probably in Constantinople, which becomes Istanbul. It's that spot there on the pivot point of Europe and Asia, right on the pretty much what we consider the dividing line of those two continents, and it plays a big role with the Persians initially. We'll talk about that area with Alexander when he invades, leading the Greek contingencies. We'll also look at that area during the Roman Empire and how it shifts from the Western Roman Empire in Rome, the center and capital of it, over to what becomes Constantinople. Later, after the Ottoman Turks and the Muslim Turks invade Constantinople, it becomes Istanbul, and today one of the more diverse cities in the world when you consider the different cultures, Eastern culture and Western culture meeting there at that pivot point. And the Ottoman Empire develops after that. Coffee becomes a pretty important drink in that area of the world and in Europe as well. And what is something that people like with their sugar and cream? I believe it's coffee. And that might be a lyric to a song by the Beastie Boys too, but you know, whatever. Second one's tea here, and I really like the image in the picture with it because it's got the green tea leaves in there. We think of tea, sometimes we think of Europeans with the pinky finger up drinking their little teacups. Yeah, they liked tea and traded for it a whole lot with the Chinese, but the initial tea, mostly green tea, and the different herbs and spices and flavorings that they could easily grow in Asia could not grow in Europe. And that's the reason that trade was so important and really out of balance for so many years. Europe wanted those spices and would do just about anything to get them. But the world trade was dominated by Asia, who had the products to trade across the Silk Roads and Sand Roads of Eurasia, and also don't forget about the ocean roads that connect India to Africa and then to the rest of the world there, that the rest of the known world at that point, because we don't have exploration happening just yet in that early in those early days. The Europeans had to trade with the middlemen of that whole system to get these spices and tea and other flavorings for their foods. Those middlemen were the North African, Middle Eastern, as we think of them today, that huge Islamic world, which they were pretty good at enforcing trade and paying tax, enforcing a tax price all along the way. Europeans weren't really very happy about having to pay that high price, and that motivated them to start doing worldwide trade, find a way to get to Asia. Columbus sailed around the western part of the world, and Mr. Da Gama, and I'm probably doing this backwards, let's see here if this is Africa to you, yeah, America, and then this way to Da Gama went down around Africa, the tip, and on to Asia to get those spices. So it's probably backwards too, which I'll do all year. Coca-Cola is real interesting. The origins of Coke, soda water, that the beverage was used as a medicine and had some early additives. One of the reasons why it's called Coca-Cola is the cocaine that originally was added to it, which I think is not probably the best idea. That would not be Coke, Diet Coke. That would not be, Pepsi Light. That'd be Pepsi Heavy. And heavily addicting and probably a bad idea. But the caffeine in it, although not hugely addicting, is something that a lot of people seem to crave, a little pick-me-up. I am probably one of those people as well. But Coca-Cola globalized the world. And that's why you see the little image over here that looks exactly like you'd see Enjoy Coca-Cola. Instead it says Enjoy Capitalism. Because in many ways, what Coca-Cola did by spreading their product across the world and marketing it to different cultures. You can see Coca-Cola in just about every country in the world. By globalizing that product, they became a huge worldwide success. And that also spread this basic idea of what it is to be an American. And pretty good spot there after we studied Coca-Cola to think about, well, we'd be in the six weeks period, right? We'll be at the end of the year preparing for the AP test after we've covered this within the scope of the school year. And it's a nice kickoff then to think about your junior year, which will take U.S. history, all 200 plus years of it. We study world history from a global perspective, and that's the next video I'm going to talk to you about, is the not only global perspective, but the beginning of that globe and how that thing even got started. It's what historians sometimes call big history, and I will create that one here for you soon. It'll be the next episode that we'll discuss big history with world history. Not a big part of the AP test, but it is certainly a big part of the world's history. Most of the world's history was when humans didn't occupy it, but we've done a pretty good job of catching up and making an impact. So thanks for tuning in here. Hopefully this helped out a little bit in thinking about the book and thinking about the origins of the book and why Tom Standage wrote it. It's a pretty decent book. I think you'll find out if you talk to some friends, maybe from other districts who are taking AP World History, that just about everybody does summer reading, or at least it's assigned to them to do. There are some other books that are far bigger, nastier, more difficult, and I think this is one that's not only interesting, but we will be studying this book, basically the concepts within the book, the entire year. So if this doesn't interest you, it's a pretty good sign that maybe this isn't for you, because it's going to move at a pretty quick pace. These summer videos will also look at what world history is, and we'll be touching on that quite a bit. I'll be kind of weaving that in here. It's a fast-paced course to get you ready for the AP test at the end of the year. May 16th. Let's see how close we are here. 326 days, 7 hours, 9 minutes, and 20 seconds. My video is running long here. I better quit. But we have a lot of work to do, and you have a lot of work to do, but that work will be worth it when you take the AP test and you get college credit for that. To enter college with 3 to 6 credit hours, and it depends on what the college you're going to enter accepts. But if you have a very good score in your AP test for world history or US history or English or some other class, you're entering college with college credit in your belt already. That's thousands of dollars of saving. Thousands of dollars that could be going into doing things in college is kind of fun, like going out to eat, having a pizza, traveling home to see your parents. Maybe you want to own or purchase a car when you're in college. And you could, if you took enough AP classes, that money potentially could go towards a car and gas money and those kinds of things that you would need. So the most important reason to take an AP class is just the fact that you are getting, you will be getting challenged in a way that's going to force you to do work at such a high level. If you can do that work here at high school, there's no question you'd be able to do that work at college. And it doesn't guarantee success in college. There's a lot of factors involved. You're away from home and boyfriend or girlfriend, and you know, there are a lot of pressures. You might be able to make, you know, $10 an hour at some job in Atascocita as a manager of some kind of fast food store, and hey, that's a good life. Maybe, but I think that you'd find out that having a college education will end up paying for itself. It's a pretty important part of life, and hopefully this course will turn you on to that idea a little bit more. It's a serious course for very serious students, but we have a lot of fun too, and so hopefully you'll see that in the course of some of these videos. I like to have a good time, and I know Ms. Jordan does as well. She's looking forward to teaching with you, and Mr. Gillespie as well. He's sometimes a fun guy. Funny looking, maybe. All right, guys. We'll see you next time on World History Summer Video Series with Mr. Duez.